Hi friends, how are you? Welcome back to my channel for a very, very different type of video. I am going to attempt creating a 6-course meal, fine dining style, all by myself. I have big dreams in my head. My fiance Jordy just turned 30, so I was like, if there's ever an excuse to go all out and try something like this, it's now. So today we are going to be doing 6 courses. Obviously, I did not prepare these in order of each course, but I'm going to be showing you the video in order of each course, 1st through 6th. But in terms of how I did this, I started off the morning with doing things like baking the dessert and then doing some sauces and then some purees and things I knew could be reheated later, and then plating some of the cold courses, and then lastly finishing with the protein so that they would be as fresh as possible. So that's kind of how we did it, but I went to my favorite spot in the world, Whole Foods, which is not close to me. It was like a 45-minute drive to get there, but it was so worth it to get all of these kind of fine ingredients, things like caviar, things like fresh scallops, creme fraiche, you know, filet mignon, like really nice things at a one-stop shop, truffles, quality cheese. And then I also took the list of things that I had kind of dreamed up preparing to a local natural wine shop, and I asked them to help me find wine pairings. I wanted to do 3 wine pairings for 6 courses because obviously that would be a waste of wine if we did any more. It kind of is a waste of wine just doing 3 alone. I know nothing about wine, but I figured a sparkling one for the first 2 courses because it's kind of caviar vibes, which I feel like works great, and then a white for the next 2 because they're fish, and a red for the next 2 because we have a red meat and a chocolate dessert. And here's the wines that they found for me. So kind of could look like I knew what I was doing, which I absolutely don't at all. But let's go ahead and get into each course, 1st through 6th, and figure it out together because Lord knows I am not a pro. So there was a lot of trial and error. Okay, let's talk 1st course. I knew the 1st 2 courses, I wanted to do something that would be pretty easy in terms of execution, more just like assembly style, not really anything that needs to be warm so that I could just assemble it, plate it, put it in the fridge, and have it ready to go for later tonight. So this is by far the most simple dish, but caviar. I mean, what is more elevated and elegant and bougie than caviar? I literally cannot think of a single thing. I went ahead and just did like a creme fraiche situation. I got fresh horseradish and I just shaved it simply, and then I chopped up some dill, I chopped up some chive, I mixed it all together, and I kind of found the inspiration for all of these dishes by simply searching on Pinterest fine dining plating, and I looked at a ton of plating photos. I didn't read any recipes, but I was like, ooh, I like that they, you know, did a creme fraiche situation on half the plate. Or later you'll see, ooh, I like the fact that they put a scallop on puree. Things like that, and I kind of pulled from what I visually liked. So I was wondering how I could get a perfectly straight line to plate this on half the plate. I went ahead and just used this bench scraper to kind of block off half of the plate and then spoon my creme fraiche on top of it. And then I laid out 3 things of caviar and additional herbs on top. And I went ahead and bought these purple potato chips because I thought they were a bit more elevated than regular potato chips. And boom, we're done. Second course, same concept. Something that looked pretty and wasn't very hard, so I could set it aside. I found this smoked fish. It was a smoked sable fish, and I kind of impulse bought it. My first idea was to do a smoked salmon, so I got both, but this smoked sable fish was really good, so for sure using that. A couple things I liked that I saw were shaved cucumber, kind of like spiraled up, like little ribbons, and I thought that was really pretty. I also saw somebody use a melon baller to get spheres of avocado, so I ordered one online, and in my mind it was gonna be so much smaller. And it was a little large, so I couldn't quite get spheres out of the avocado, but those 2 things alone were kind of like my inspiration for visually interesting things. So I kind of wanted to do a smoked fish and cucumber salad with kind of a lime citrus type of note to it. And I didn't want to put like a vinaigrette over everything because I thought it could just like look sloppy. So I went ahead and coated the avocado in just olive oil and lime. I also know that will help keep it from browning. So I was like, okay, practical and adds flavor. I'm down for it. And I cut up the sable fish into smaller, kind of more symmetrical pieces. And I got to plating. I had leftover creme fraiche, so I figured, okay, we can use that on the plate to add a little bit of extra like creaminess and fattiness. Although in hindsight, I wish I did something cool like mixed it with matcha or charcoal or like a chlorophyll or something to give it a dark color, because then I think it would have had really nice contrast on these white plates. I also should just slowly make or find more plates if I do this more. But I just went ahead and spread that on the plate a bit. I had also bought this yuzu tangy umami kind of mayo, which I thought could also add some creaminess. I didn't love it slash it is yet again white, so it didn't really show up. But just for a little bit more creaminess and extra flavor, I added that as well. But I started just kind of playing around with plating, adding my little cucumber ribbons, adding the little avocado. And then I had the thought of, oh, I shouldn't waste the smoked salmon. So I tried kind of plating it, but I didn't like the way it looked visually. I kind of liked the more monochromatic of different shades of like greens and whites with the sable fish. So I scratched that and we had it for breakfast the next morning. Don't worry, it didn't actually go to waste. But my favorite thing is edible flowers. I love edible flowers and they actually do add a nice kind of like herbiness, freshness, yet again, another very light flavor. So I added a ton of edible flowers, some capers, some dill. And then since I only had the lime vinaigrette on the avocado, I just shaved lime zest over top. So it was very light in flavor. Really, you get the smokiness from the fish more than anything, and like a little bit of lime from the avocado and a little bit of citrus from the mayo, but otherwise like a very, very, very light and simple dish. I was really excited about this because I had such a vision. I ordered basically scallop shells, like seashells, to plate individual scallops on. And I also ordered a ton of pink salt in bulk to hold those shells in place on a plate. So I went in with like a very strong vision for the plating, which made me excited. And I'm also, oh, I love scallops. Scallops are so good. So I wanted to do it on a parsnip puree. I thought that that would be really good. And I had seen people pair scallop and parsnip before. So I just went ahead and shaved the skin off the parsnip. I normally like leaving like potato skins and stuff on, but I wanted a really, really smooth puree. So I shaved that, I chopped that up, and I got to boiling it. I started to fill a pot with water to boil it, and then I was like, you know what? Actually, I could get so much more flavor if I use a broth. So I went to go see if I had any broth, and I had a chicken broth. I don't know if pairing chicken and scallops is like a sin in the culinary world, but hey, any little way to get in more flavor, I was game. So got that going on the stovetop with my parsnips and my broth. And then I think I also, yeah, I added in some ginger as well. So kind of like a parsnip ginger kind of, you know, funky situation. I went and chopped some scallions, garlic to add a little bit more savory flavor in there as well, because parsnips lean a little sweet. And first started off with just a hand potato masher to see what consistency I'd get. Added some salt and pepper for seasoning, added some heavy cream, and I decided, you know what, I want it smooth, smooth. So I went ahead and took it on over to the blender. I blended it up and I gave it a little taste and I was like, honestly, I want it more savory. So I added some tamari, just some gluten-free soy sauce. I feel like that's just a slightly more depth of flavor as opposed to adding more salt, and blended that up. And honestly, it was really good. So I just set that aside in a container to reheat later once it was time to actually plate. And then I started prepping some of the other parts of the dish. I wanted to do pine nuts. When did pine nuts get so expensive? I knew they were expensive, but not this expensive. The bag was like $17. Ridiculous. But I just toasted up the pine nuts on the stovetop until they got a little bit brown. They kind of smelled like popcorn. It's been a while since I've toasted pine nuts. And then I started on my sauce. So I had this idea of doing a brown butter pomegranate sauce with like fresh pomegranate. I did not know how it would go to put actual fresh pomegranate seeds into hot brown butter, but I figured if there's time to experiment, it's now. So let's experiment. I got the butter going, got it kind of browned. Once it was getting close, I just popped in some of the pomegranate. I predicted this might happen. They started popping like popcorn, like like you could hear them.
As they popped, they started to release the juice into the brown butter. And I love that you still got some texture. The little seeds were still in the sauce, and the sauce turned a little bit darker in color. But to make it yet again a little more savory, I found this balsamic. It was a living balsamic. I guess it just means it has probiotics. I don't know. But it was a blueberry pomegranate. So I added a splash of that for color, for acidity as well, to hopefully balance the dish a little bit more. Flash forward to later in the night, and it was time to plate. So as I mentioned, very specific vision for this one. I went ahead and I added the salt, then the shells, and then it was time for me to cook the scallops. I did not cook the scallops until it was time to actually eat this course, because scallops only take like 2 minutes per side. So I just, between courses, stood up and was like, I will be back in 6 minutes. You know, had the scallops already seasoned, ready to go, which I think you're not supposed to season them too far in advance. You know, got the pan hot, did a little sear on each side, and then it was time to put them on their shells. So I laid the shells down. I added the now rewarmed parsnip puree with the scallop on top. And then I spooned over some of the pomegranate brown butter. I put the toasted pine nuts, just kind of sprinkled them on top. And then I topped it with micro cilantro, which I was kind of like, is cilantro weird with this? Because I always associate cilantro with Mexican dishes, but it was actually really great. It had, you know, slightly different flavor from regular cilantro being micro, and it added like a great bright freshness to the dish as well. So this was my favorite, very proud of it. I'll stop talking about it now. Please enjoy. Out of all the courses, I would consider this to be kind of the least elevated, the most just like homegrown cooking kind of thing, but I used some pretty fancy ingredients, and it was Jordy's favorite course out of all the ones. So sometimes I guess like comfort cooking is best, but this is going to be a black truffle and crab mac and cheese with brie and gouda, and goodness, it was really good. So started off, I found just gluten-free panko, and I just browned that with some butter and some garlic on the stovetop. I added in some sage just to kind of infuse it. I didn't know how much of that flavor would actually be left in the breadcrumb, but it worked pretty well. I kind of made, I guess you'd call it a roux, or would you call it like, what is a bechamel? See, this is why I gotta go to school. I don't know my terminology, but I started with, yet again, chopping up another scallion, some more garlic, classic. Also, opening the white wine, because I knew no way would we ever get through 3 bottles of wine, especially considering the fact that I am just now learning to even drink wine. So I normally have like 2 sips and I'm like, I'm good, I'm done. So I opened that up for our little sauce as well to get the mac and cheese started. On the stovetop, I melted some butter. I added in the scallions and the garlic. Scallions first, because they take a little bit longer. I didn't want the garlic to burn. Threw in some more sage there as well, because, you know, why not? I liked the way it added to the breadcrumb. And then I went ahead and just spooned in a bit of gluten-free flour. It's just like the one-to-one baking flour. I added in some white wine very slowly and some cream very slowly. And it was, you know, thick and sticky, which I hoped was a good thing. I haven't really done anything like this before because I'm gluten-free, and so sometimes it's easier to just not. Salted, peppered, and then I was like, okay, I think it's time to add in the cheese. I let the guy at Whole Foods pick out which cheeses I would use. I told him what I was aiming for, and he was like, do you want like funkier flavor, lighter flavor? And I was like, let's go funky. So he picked out this brie that was like very gooey. I didn't want to get the wax rind in it. And it was hard to like salvage out the brie, but I did save 2 little slices and set it aside for like plating purposes if I wanted to try to bake 2 kind of sticking out of it. Cause I had seen somebody do that when I was looking at plating, as they did like a brie mac with the little corner of cheese sticking out. I got fresh pasta as opposed to like fully dried. I don't know, it cooks a lot quicker. I don't know if it makes a huge difference, but I like this little like fuselli shape that they had at Whole Foods. So I just got that in the refrigerated section. It boils for like 2 minutes. I went ahead and just did canned crab. I wasn't about to crack a ton of claws. And threw in the noodles, mixed it all together. And I went ahead and plated them into ramekins that I was gonna throw into the oven later. Oh, and did I mention the black truffle? I didn't get fresh truffle, but I got like full
soaked in oil pieces of truffle, and I used all of them. I put a lot into the mixture, but then I also saved some for on top so that you could actually visually see it sticking out. And plated this with the breadcrumb on top and set it aside. And basically, when we were eating the course before, just pop that in the oven until we were done, and then it was ready to go. Nice and warm, and the breadcrumbs got a little crispy and crunchy on top, and it was pretty perfect. Finally, the fifth course, the last of our savory courses, I wanted to attempt a filet mignon. I love steak and squash together. I feel like they pair really nicely. So I just bought some butternut squash, just toasted it in the oven early in the day in my little like Tovala Smart oven to set that aside with olive oil, salt, pepper, very simple. And then pulled that out of the oven and made a little puree in my blender again. I need to get an immersion blender. I used to own one. I don't know what happened. I left a ton of stuff in California when I had to move home kind of abruptly, and that was one thing that I missed. I also had bought this kind of umami sauce at Whole Foods, and it's, they call it kind of like a cheat sauce where you can just add it in to your already existing sauces or whatever to get more flavor. And it was strong, but I liked it. It added some brightness. Normally I associate umami with like very like rich and dark, but this definitely had some acidity to it. So added that in with the puree, some butter, some thyme I thought would be kind of nice. And I just blended that up, some cream to get it to the right consistency, and tasting as I went to add a little bit more umami, whatever. Just vibing it out until I liked the consistency and the taste of it, and I thought it was pretty good. And I decided to store it in a piping bag because I knew I wanted to do something interesting with the plating. I didn't know quite what yet, but I put it in the piping bag for now because I figured I could reheat it like that later, snip the tip, and then like figure it out as I went. Then I moved on to the sauce for this dish. Yet again, another brown butter sauce. Don't blame me, I'm from Texas. Gotta do Kerrygold, it's the best here in the States. I decided to make a brown butter mustard sauce. Yet again, found another kind of like fun, already existing sauce at Whole Foods. It was just a hot deli mustard that was like a little bit more vinegary than a lot of the just plain mustards that you could buy. So I browned the butter, and once it was getting close, added the mustard in and basically whisked that until I felt like it was at a good spot. And I set that aside for plating later. Finally, mushrooms. I love steak and mushrooms together. I was a little stressed about how I get color into this dish because in my mind I was like, steak is brown, mushrooms are brown, butternut squash is orangey brown. But I was like, I'll figure it out when I get there. I had bought random herbs to kind of test with dishes later in case I needed to plate them more beautifully. But I found this mix of mushrooms. Honestly, could not tell you what types of mushrooms these are, except for they're cute. There's like big, thick boys, and then there's little like fingers. I thought they were really cute. So sauteed them with some oil, salt, pepper, butter. Started with the thick ones because I knew they'd take a lot longer. They took a long time, but the little finger guys went really fast. And then set those aside. And the way that I prepped the meat to be ready to serve later is, you know, normally you do a quick sear on each side and then you finish it in the oven. So what I did, and who knows, maybe this is a bad thing, I don't know real technique, is I went ahead and seared each side and then set it aside covered in foil. And then when we were eating the course before, I finished it in the oven so that it would be nice and hot and not overcooked, let it rest, and then sliced it right before serving. So let's get to the plating portion of this. I'm not gonna lie, I am not used to sipping wine, and I had tasted the first two types of wine with Jordy, and I was feeling it. So my plating got a little more chaotic as time went on, but I had a lot of fun. I kind of like the way it turned out because it turned out very whimsical and chaotic. Okay, I also want to say a note. I don't want to hear anybody say anything about me using my fingers, okay? I clearly would not do this if it was not for me and my fiance, but A, it's easier. B, we kiss, so we're not worried about each other's germs. But I used my fingers to plate a lot of this, kind of placing the mushrooms around like they were kind of, you know, growing out of the forest floor around the steak. And then I took my piping bag with my butternut squash and I started piping just random dollops. And I was like, this is fun. And I kept going and I created this very weird, almost leaf-like pattern growing out of the forest floor with the mushrooms as well. I don't know, guys, like I said, I was feeling tipsy. I'm not used to tasting wine. So it kind of, to me, felt like we just, you know, stumbled upon this very unique forest floor with mushrooms and dollops and leaves growing out of it and a plated brown butter mustard steak. This ended up being one of my favorite plating and tasting things, but I have to say I am not a baker, okay? Not at all. The reason why is I don't like to follow instruction, and you kind of have to follow instruction to bake. So I took some shortcuts and tried some things. Some things worked, some things didn't. But basically, I had in my mind a miso dark chocolate brownie, and I wanted to just find some fun ice cream. So I found a bourbon vanilla bean ice cream, and then I wanted to do something coming out of it. And I thought miso chocolate sesame brittle, maybe like a sesame bark, sesame brittle. But the thing is, I haven't caramelized or done any sort of sugar work since my sophomore year food chemistry class in college. If y'all don't know, I went to school for nutrition. I don't remember if I've mentioned that in this video yet or not. So I did have to do some like food labs, but it has been a long time. So I also could not find any sort of corn syrup or glucose or anything like that at Whole Foods. So I was like, I'm gonna just attempt with just sugar and water and see what happens. I tried this a couple times. The first time, I did sugar, water, let it dissolve, let it heat up to 300 degrees, stirred in the sesame seeds, which they already were toasted. I was planning on toasting them, but I think they were already toasted, which is great. And then I tried the kind of more old-fashioned like peanut brittle technique where you add in butter and baking soda. I think what had happened, my butter was really cold and so it seized the sugar a lot quicker, but I could not get the sugar to get like a dark color. I don't know if that's because I wasn't using the corn syrup or the glucose, but I took it above 300 degrees and it still wasn't really darkening the way I had hoped. So I went ahead and just poured it, but it was hard to work with because I think the butter cooled it way too quickly. So I figured, let's try it again, no butter. So I did it again, 300 degrees, just sugar, water, sesame. And this one was a little bit easier to work with. I was at least able to roll it out a little bit thinner. The butter one obviously tasted better because it had fat, but the consistency and the texture of the one without the butter was better. And so I just went ahead and used that. And I was a little bit sad at like the color of it, but I found a solution later that we will get to. But next thing I did is I went ahead and made the brownies. I took a shortcut here, guys. I used the box mix. I was not about to do this from scratch because this day alone took me 10 hours. So if I could save another hour, I was gonna do it. And I found this really great dark chocolate. I think it was the King Arthur brownie mix. And I went ahead and made it my own. So I just mixed the brownie and then I stirred in a ton of really super dark chocolate chips and started to play with the miso. I got white miso. I love white miso. It is just so interesting and complex and funky and pairs with chocolate so well. So first I just mixed some into the batter and I tasted it and I was like, honestly, I want some more. So I mixed more into the batter and I tasted it and I was like, okay, I can taste it, but I kind of want some more. So I spooned the batter into the little baking sheet and I went ahead and whipped together some white miso and some butter to create a miso butter. And you know how they do that with like caramel brownies? They'll basically, or cream cheese or whatever, you'll put it on top and then you'll kind of spiral it around. I did that and I baked it and it created like these like butter miso kind of divots in the chocolate. And I'm really glad that that worked out, because it was really good. I had a plating vision as well, but I don't even own a cookie cutter. So I had all these visions and was like, I'm gonna have to just be creative with how I go about it. So I wanted to do a like cocoa circle. And so I took some bowls that I had that were small, put them down and sprinkle the cocoa powder over top, remove the bowl so there was like a perfect circle. And then I wanted to cut these brownies into circles. And so I found a stemless wine glass and just pressed it down into the middle of the brownie pan to get these into a circle. Don't worry, we ate the edges later. We gave it to friends. But it was hilarious because obviously it was not a cookie cutter, so I didn't have a way to push it out from the outside. Anyways, got it eventually. And then I had the idea. I was thinking about my brittle and I was thinking about the color of it and how it made me sad. And I was like, what I wish I had was like gold foil or like edible gold paint. Like I wish I could like paint this gold or something. That would be really fun. And I remember that recently I had bought luster dust for cocktails and mocktails, which you put it in liquid and it makes your drink like pearlescent. And I was like, what if I tried just like putting luster dust on the brittle? And so I tried it and it actually looked super cool. And I was like, awesome, that's great. So basically right before we were about to eat this course, I plated the ice cream and the brittle because everything else could just sit at room temp and be fine. And I found this vanilla bourbon ice cream that was labeled gluten-free, which is great because bourbon things sometimes aren't. And I remembered learning how to do this. I worked on the line in the kitchen for like 6 or 8 months when I was young. We would have like a citrus panna cotta and different desserts that we would have to scoop with a hot spoon into the shape that I should remember the name of. Please comment it down below. And the chef, that was like one of the first things he taught me was how to do that. And it's been a long time, but I tried my best to also scoop the ice cream in that shape. Scooped that on top of the brownie, placed a couple pieces of the sesame bark shards, and then I bought a bar of dark chocolate and shaved that with my microplane yet again to get a little bit of chocolate shavings over top. And that is it. That is the completion of my meal. I'm really grateful to have the opportunity to do this, and I think I want to start doing this like once or twice a month, just like dedicating a whole day to cooking really fun things that my brain dreams up and having fun plating it and maybe having friends over and serving them. I don't know. I think it could be really fun. So let me know your thoughts. I know this is very different from the content I usually do, but to be honest, with me starting culinary school in a few months, there probably will be more food content sprinkled in throughout the everyday vlogs. So that's kind of what I hope to incorporate a little bit. Don't worry, you're not going to lose the normal content. It will just be in addition to. But thanks for joining me. I had a great time. I love y'all. I hope you have the best rest of your day, and I'll see you in a video very soon. Bye.